पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव फीडबैक, हाँ नेगेटिव, इट हैज टू सप्रेस एंटी रिपिट्यूटरी, बट देर इज अ ट्यूमर हियर, नो मैटर यू सेक्रेट 1000 ml ऑफ कॉर्टिसोल इन योर बॉडी, इट कैनॉट सप्रेस अ ट्यूमर, बिकॉज आई टोल्ड यू नो हार्मोन इन योर बॉडी कैन कंट्रोल अ ट्यूमर, इट इज एन इंडिपेंडेंट, यू अंडरस्टूड इट. सो एट द एंड वेन यू टेक द ब्लड एनालिसिस वॉट यू फाइंड, इंक्रीज ACTH एंड इंक्रीज कॉर्टिसोल. So what is the difference in both of them? Cortisol is the same, increased. But here there is decreased ACTH, increased ACTH. Clear? Right? And how this patient will come? He will also come with the complaints of what? High blood pressure and all of this cortisol complaints. Additionally, he will tell that, doctor, I have severe headache in my... Severe headache in the sense, headache is in the brain only, right? He will tell, doctor, I have severe headache, throbbing headache and all these complaints. Okay, he doesn't complain of any headache and he complains of headache. So this is called as Cushing disease. This is called as Cushing disease. You understood this? Right. The next thing is, there is also another way through which you can release cortisol. Another way is, look here. These are the lungs. And here is your adrenal gland. Now, heavy smokers, chronic smokers, daily 2 packs for 30 years, 20 years, so these are called 20 pack year history, 30 pack year history, right? So such heavy smokers, they will have what? Kidney cancer or lung cancer? Lung. They will have lung cancer, right? So definitely they will have lung cancer. Now, you know what? This cancer causes release of ACTH. How is that is? Let me write it first. This cancer causes release of ACTH. Normally, ACTH, when I tell ACTH, you will think of only anterior pituitary, right? There are also sites where this hormone, this ACTH hormone is released other than the anterior pituitary. This is called as ectopic production. Ectopic in the sense other than the normal site. You are understanding it? So this ACTH might not be natural ACTH which was released from anterior pituitary, but functionally and structurally it is same. See, natural is always natural, right? So this ACTH is not called just ACTH, it is called ectopic ACTH. This is called ectopic ACTH. Clear? Ectopic production of ACTH. Ectopic production of ACTH happens from the lungs. Now, not only ACTH, you know, parathyroid hormone, from where it is released? Normally parathyroid glands. Even in some cases of lung cancer also, from the lungs PTH is released. That is called ectopic PTH release. Sometimes ADH is also released. This is called ectopic ADH release. Okay, we'll discuss everything in detail, don't worry, but for now, according to the topic, you have to remember this ectopic ACTH release. Clear? Everyone. Now, this ectopic ACTH is acting as a normal ACTH. Now, what will happen? This ectopic ACTH also activates the adrenal cortex, and adrenal cortex causes increase in release of cortisol. And for example, if I make a pituitary here, this is your pituitary gland. Now, what happens? This cortisol should activate or inhibit?
Inhibit.
So, there will be less production of ACTH, less production of natural ACTH, okay? Now, when you check his blood, there will be low ACTH, high cortisol and high ectopic ACTH. You are understanding it, or you are getting confused? You are understanding, no problem, right? Right?
We can differentiate between natural and ectopic.
structurally there might be, I will tell you how to differentiate, how to diagnose this all, I'll tell you in a minute, but for now just believe that there is ectopic release of ACTH from the lungs. Okay, you might ask, what cancer is this? What cancer causes this release? Are paraneoplastic cancer, very important in your pathology, remember it. Paraneoplastic tumors or paraneoplastic cancers. Para means other than, neo means new secretion, right? ACTH is newly secreted from the lungs. Paraneoplastic cancer or paraneoplastic tumor, right? And paraneoplastic tumors, there are different types. Some tumors, they release ACTH. Some paraneoplastic tumors, they release PTH. Some of them, they even release ADH, right? So you understood this. Now a patient comes to me, no headache, nothing, everything is fine. Sometimes he might feel that he is having high blood pressure, and he will tell me some complaints of cortisol, more cortisol. In this condition, when I check his blood, if I find more cortisol and decrease ACTH, right, I can put him a diagnosis as he is having cancer in the lungs, paraneoplastic, or Cushing syndrome, right? Now, I have to put any one diagnosis, right? Now, how do I put? I will cut his gland or lungs and see? No. What he will complain? He will complain that, doctor, I have cough also. I have problem with the breathing. Right? I can't walk for about, I can't climb two floors. And he'll tell, I'm a smoker at the end. So then you need to think of that. Clear with this? Now, if patient tells their complaints, it is well and good. The every diagnosis will be completed with a single blood test. Sometimes patients are item patients, you know. They don't tell complaints. They tell, I am fine, everything is fine, nothing happened to me. Sometimes little bit headache, they will be having severe headache, but they will be telling little bit headache. Sometimes they will be having little cough, and they also know why they are coughing. So when such patients come to you, then the diagnosis is difficult. Then what you have to do? You have to do further test. See, in all of them cortisol is increased, right? In all of them cortisol is increased. Now, by what criteria will you put the patient as lung cancer, or will you put the patient as anterior pituitary adenoma or adrenal adenoma? It is dexamethasone test. When such patients come to you, the next important test you have to do is dexamethasone test. Dexamethasone test. You know, dexamethasone, prednisone, methylprednisone, all these are what? Corticosteroids. All of them have a common chemical name called as cortisol. They are different drugs. You are understanding? Like Calpol, paracetamol, and all of this. The basic thing is what? Painkiller. In the same way, the basic thing here is cortisol. But there are different drug names like methylprednisone, prednisone, hydrocortisone, or methylprednisone, which I already told you. So these are different drugs. So what I give to the patient is, immediately when a patient comes to me with some complaints which I feel that he is having Cushing, to confirm it, what I do is, instead of doing all these tests, I just do dexamethasone test. Now, what is dexamethasone test? Listen very carefully. Dexamethasone. There are two forms of dexamethasone. Generally 1 mg and 8 mg. 8 mg is called as high dose dexamethasone. 1 mg is called as low dose dexamethasone. 1 mg, when you give, it acts on adrenal gland. Okay? It acts on adrenal gland. When I give 8 mg, it acts on pituitary gland. Pituitary gland. This is the thing you have to remember, and rest or I'll take care. You remember this? Just store it. 1 mg is adrenal, 8 mg it acts on pituitary gland. Clear? Now patient is coming to me, he will tell his complaints. I feel that he is having some Cushing features. Okay? He is having some Cushing features like moon-like face, buffalo hump, hypertension and all of that. So to confirm it, I give dexamethasone test. First what I do is, okay, let us talk about the normal patient. I am normal now. If you give me dexamethasone of 1 mg, it will act on adrenal gland. Act on the adrenal gland in the sense, it will suppress the adrenal gland. When it suppresses the adrenal gland, low cortisol or high cortisol?
Low.
So if you are giving me dexamethasone to a patient, if there is low cortisol, it means he is normal, right? Normally, if I give you dexamethasone of 1 mg, your adrenal gland will be suppressed temporarily and there will be low cortisol. Yes or no?
Yes.
But even after giving dexamethasone, normally adrenal gland has to suppress, but if it didn't suppress, it will release more cortisol, right? After giving 1 mg dexamethasone, if you find increased level of cortisol, then you have to think there might be tumor here which caused increased cortisol, or there might be tumor here which caused increased cortisol, or there might be tumor here which caused increased cortisol. Right? You're understanding this? One thing you got confirmed is patient had problem out of these three. One out of these three. You know that. Exactly which place, for that you need to do 8 mg dexamethasone test. Till now you are clear?
Yes.
Now patient comes to me, I'll give him 1 mg dexamethasone. I will look his blood. Increase cortisol levels. When increased cortisol levels are there, then immediately I will write that next day morning you have to come and do 8 mg dexamethasone test. Okay? Now 8 mg dexamethasone test suppresses the pituitary gland. Now what did I tell you? I told you that no hormone in our body can suppress a tumor. For some exceptions. This is the exception. Dexamethasone, even though there is a tumor, this 8 mg, I mean high dose dexamethasone, can suppress this tumor, resulting in low ACTH and low cortisol. Okay? You're clear? If I have a tumor, you give me 8 mg dexamethasone and check my blood levels. Previously it was high cortisol. Now after giving this, I'll have low cortisol. Clear? Right. Now look. So about this I'll discuss here. So patient came to me, I gave 1 mg dexamethasone, cortisol levels are high. Immediately I'll give 8 mg dexamethasone. If I give 8 mg dexamethasone, if his cortisol levels come to normal, it means what should I think? Right, there is a tumor in anterior pituitary. Did everyone understand what I told?
Yes.
Tell me or else again I'll explain.
Okay.
See, what did I tell you? If I have one of these three problems, right? But I don't know what. 8 mg can act only on the pituitary, not on the adrenal or lungs. It can act only on the pituitary. Clear? If I have tumor here, if you are giving 8 mg dexamethasone, what will happen? This tumor will be suppressed. When tumor is suppressed, cortisol levels will be low. Right? It means I have pituitary tumor. Clear? Okay, you give me 8 mg dexamethasone. I am telling you secretly that I have a lung cancer. You give me 8 mg dexamethasone. Right? Will this dexamethasone act on the lungs?
No.
No. It has a capacity to act only on the pituitary gland. Even though you give 8 mg multiple times, it cannot act on lungs. So, cortisol levels are always kept high. You are understanding it?
Yes.
Everyone?
Yes.
So, even after giving 8 mg dexamethasone, my cortisol levels, if still they are high, it means I don't have any problem in the pituitary gland. Rather, I have a problem in the lungs. Clear so far? You have question marks on your face. You are clear?
Yes. It could be the lungs or
the adrenal gland, you are telling? Yeah, for adrenal gland, generally, we do this test. ACTH and cortisol. And patient with adrenal tumor, adrenal gland is located here. He will have a big lump here. Swelling. Okay? And moreover, this is very, very rare, 1%. Mainly, these two are the problems. Clear? Now, you tell me. High cortisol levels, I have done 8 mg dexamethasone. Even after doing 8 mg dexamethasone, cortisol levels are low now. Suddenly, cortisol levels became low. So, what is the problem? Very good. Cushing disease. After giving 8 mg dexamethasone, still cortisol levels are high. Then what is the problem? Very good. Problem with the lung. Paraneoplastic tumor. Now you understood?
Yes.
How to differentiate between... I know it will be confusing. If you revise it, open the notes and revise, it will be easy. Okay? Because if you don't understand this, you can't even do any question. I'm telling you. You understood this? Clear? Still, what should I risk? So, this is all about cortisol. Clear? This is all about cortisol. Now, you know the functions of cortisol. You know what will happen when cortisol is increased and decreased. And you also know what are the different diseases like Cushing disease and Cushing syndrome and paraneoplastic. Clear so far? Shall I go for another topic? Right? Let us go for aldosterone now. The next part. It is released from where? At the end, you are understanding? You are understanding, right? Yeah. Yeah. Now tell me, what is the next hormone? Aldosterone, from where is it released? And who releases aldosterone? Very good. Cortisol. And there is one more thing which happens in our body that causes release of aldosterone. I told you in the last class. Students who are new to this class, you can watch the video. It is already uploaded. I mean the previous class videos. Okay. What causes release of aldosterone? One is, you told me, cortisol. And the next one is? Yeah, angiotensin 2, right? But what causes angiotensin 2 release? Why renin is released? Very good. Low blood pressure, low blood volume causes release of aldosterone. And second thing is, cortisol causes release of aldosterone. Clear? Right. Now, okay, mainly, for example, if I met with an accident, I lose some amount of blood. So when I lose some amount of blood, aldosterone level will increase, right? When I lose some amount of blood, it means my intravascular volume is decreased or increased? Decreased. Decreased intravascular volume causes activation of which system? Renin-angiotensin system. In which there will be, I discussed this renin-angiotensin in detail last class, you remember? Right. So there will be increased renin. Clear? When there is increased renin, in turn, it causes increase in level of angiotensin 2. When angiotensin 2 is increased, it will cause increase in level of aldosterone. And what does aldosterone do? It will take water and sodium back into the blood. Right? So, it causes sodium and water reabsorption. And it will excrete potassium into the urine. So, if I take more aldosterone, and when you check the urine, in the urine you will have more potassium. Why? Because aldosterone is leaving the potassium into the urine and it is taking the sodium into the blood. So, when you check my blood, sodium levels will be high. When you check the urine, potassium levels will be high. Clear? Hypernatremia and hypokalemia in the blood. Clear? So, this is the thing. In this, what is the primary problem? Low blood pressure was the primary problem. As a result, there was release of renin. This is the secondary. This is primary. So, this phenomena where there is increased aldosterone as a result of decreased intravascular volume is called as what? Secondary hyperaldosteronism. Secondary to what? Renin is released secondary to decreased intravascular volume. So, secondary hyperaldosteronism. Clear with this? Right? You're not clear? You're clear? The next one is, look here. Okay, let us think that my blood pressure, everything is normal. But, okay, tell me which cells are releasing aldosterone? Zona glomerulosa. Let us think if there is a tumor in the zona glomerulosa. Then what will happen? There will be increased amount of aldosterone. Right? So there will be more sodium in my body or less sodium? In my body? More sodium. So there will be more sodium plus more water in our in my body. And in my body, the potassium level will be? Less potassium in my body. Yes or no? So when there is more aldosterone, more sodium and water is taken back into my blood. It means in my blood, the volume is increased or decreased?
Increased.
Huh? Sodium water is entering into my blood. Increased. Blood volume is increased. It means I will have hypertension or hypotension?
Hypertension.
In this case? In this case, hypotension. Hypotension in this case. But in this case, hypertension. Clear? Right. So, increase sodium, increase aldosterone. So, what will happen? Increase intravascular volume. Now, when intravascular volume is increased, will renin be released?
No.
Renin is released only when the blood volume is decreased. So, increase intravascular volume will cause decreased renin or increase?
Decreased
renin. You're clear with this? Now, where is the primary problem? Adrenal gland. Primary problem is here. So, this is called as primary hyperaldosteronism. Other name for this is Kohn's syndrome. Kohn's syndrome. Right? C-O-N-N-S, Kohn's syndrome. Now look here, if I give you a case where patient had just, increase in sodium and decrease potassium plus hypotension, then it is primary or secondary? Secondary. Why hypotension? Because intravascular volume is reduced. If I give you a case where there is increased sodium, decreased potassium very severely and hypertension.
Primary.
You are understanding? It is called primary. Because in primary you will have increased intravascular volume, blood volume is increased, so hypertension. Clear? Simple thing, in any question, normally potassium level is between 3.325 millimole per liter or milli equivalent per liter. Both of them are the same. This is the level of potassium. Okay? Clear? Any question, you find hypertension in the patient plus hypokalemia, low potassium and high blood pressure, blindly put the option as primary hyperaldosteronism or Kohn's syndrome. Clear? Hypertension plus hypokalemia is seen only in this case. When you'll do the questions, you'll understand. Clear? You understood this? So far what we have discussed? We have discussed things which increase through adrenal gland. For example, increased cortisol we have discussed. What are the things where cortisol levels will be increased? Cushing disease, Cushing syndrome and ectopic release. And at the same time we have also discussed increased level of aldosterones and all. Now we'll go exactly opposite. What will happen when there is decreased aldosterone level? Okay? and decrease cortisol level. When who are releasing this aldosterone and cortisol? Your adrenal cortex. If adrenal cortex, through some or the other reason, if they are not able to release these hormones, then what pathology you have to call it as? You have to call it as adrenal insufficiency, right? Because insufficiently they are secreting these hormones. Adrenal insufficiency. What do you mean by adrenal insufficiency? Adrenal insufficiency means adrenal gland is not able to release aldosterone or not able to release cortisol, right? There are two types of adrenal insufficiency. One is called as primary adrenal insufficiency and another one is called as secondary adrenal insufficiency. Okay? One is called as primary adrenal insufficiency and the other one is called as secondary adrenal insufficiency. Now, what is primary and what is secondary? See, whenever I tell you primary, it means you have to think actually from where the hormones are released. If I tell aldosterone and if I tell primary, you have to think where aldosterone is released from where? No, from adrenal gland. Yeah, from adrenal gland, right? So when I tell primary, it means the place from where it is released has a problem. Okay, when I tell secondary, the place from where it is not released, that is causing the inhibition of this one. If I tell primary adrenal insufficiency, means primary problem is to adrenal gland. When I tell secondary adrenal insufficiency, adrenal gland is normal, some or the other things are causing the depression of adrenal gland. That is secondary. When I tell primary adrenal insufficiency, it means there is a problem within the adrenal gland where adrenal gland is not releasing the hormones. Right? What are the problems it can be?
Tumor.
No.
Degeneration of cells.
How? I mean, simple thing. Trauma. When adrenal gland, when there's a trauma to the adrenal gland, can it release hormones?
No.
So first thing is trauma. Second thing is?
Autoimmune.
Very good. Autoimmune. And third thing is infections, right? They cause hemorrhage of the adrenal gland. Remember this thing, the most important and most common is Neisseria meningitis. Neisseria meningitis. It causes hemorrhage of the adrenal gland. So when there is hemorrhage of adrenal gland does not release its own hormones. Right? Another two infections are TB, HIV. So out of all these, which is the most 99% common cause is? What? Trauma. Everyone will have accident or what? No. Very good. Autoimmune is the most important cause. If I ask you what is the most common cause of primary adrenal insufficiency, autoimmune. Okay? Autoimmune. In secondary adrenal insufficiency, adrenal gland is normal. Fine. But what is causing activation of adrenal gland? ACTH. From where ACTH is released? Pituitary. If pituitary is damaged, can ACTH be released?
No.
No ACTH. When there is no ACTH, will cortisol and aldosterone be released?
No.
So the primary problem was here. As a result, primary problem was here. As a result, this organ was suffering. So this is called secondary adrenal insufficiency. What is the most common cause of secondary adrenal insufficiency? Most. Very rare. Trauma. First one always should be trauma. And the second will be the most common cause. Life is not so simple. No infection. Okay, see here. for example, if I had some organ transplant, then what doctor will give me? Glucocorticoids. So daily I will take cortisol. So cortisol is entering into my body, and that cortisol, which that synthetic cortisol which I'm taking, will it cause negative feedback to this or positive?
Negative.
Negative feedback. As a result, low ACTH and low cortisol. Right? So most common cause of secondary adrenal insufficiency is exogenous glucocorticoid therapy. Right? Exogenous administration of glucocorticoids is the most common. This is the most common cause. Everything which I am discussing will be in the question paper today. So better remember it. See, secondary patient will tell, doctor, I am taking that drugs, I had that problem and all. So by that you can think it is secondary. But primary, if patient had autoimmune, in a day adrenal gland will be damaged. Autoimmune is a chronic process. Slowly the antibodies go there, little by little they'll damage. Patient won't even know that. So how you'll diagnose it?
Can I ask a question for that? If they are taking exogenous glucocorticoids, their cortisol and other ones are already increased.
Yes.
So there's an insufficiency.
See, when they're taking exogenous glucocorticoids, for example, if I am taking exogenous glucocorticoids, that synthetic cortisol is acting as a normal cortisol, right? So it means my cortisol levels are increased. So when my cortisol levels are increased, that will undergo negative feedback. When there is negative feedback, there is low ACTH. When there is low ACTH, then there is low production of natural cortisol. What matters is natural. iPhone is iPhone. The same thing. Natural cortisol level is decreased, right? So you understood this? Some are still confused.
No.
You understood this, right? Now look here, this is hypothalamus, right? In the hypothalamus, you have a special nucleus here. You call it as PVN, that is, very good, paraventricular nucleus. Paraventricular nucleus releases a hormone, and this hormone is called as corticotropic releasing hormone. Okay, it is called corticotropic releasing hormone. Now, in the anterior pituitary, you have some cells. For example, this cell,